Everybody's welcome to this program. I will speak in English and maybe sometime in Kurdish. Because some of our guests maybe don't speak so good English. So today we are here because of this fantastic book, Kurdistan Tour Guide. And it's a book, it's an unusual book from Kurdistan because everybody is speaking about Daesh and the problems, the victims and the war. But today we have a guest who speaks about the tourism of Kurdistan and how wonderful the country of the Kurds is. And also with these fantastic pictures, I heard that about 4,000 pictures has been taken before they started to elect the books, the photographs. And this book has also another very important thing is that all kind of the rich culture of the Kurds, by diversity, the religions, and especially there is also some chapters about the Yazidis in this book, and the Galesh, and you know the holy place of the Yazidis who have been victims in August 2, 2014, and so this is actually, we can say that it has two important messages. The first one is that the life goes on in Kurdistan. No one can stop the life is going on in Kurdistan. And the second is that the Kurdistan is a very beautiful and touristic place if the owners of Kurdistan or the members of Kurdistan or the inhabitants of the Kurdistan can take care of Kurdistan, it will be a kind of Switzerland in the Middle East. So with these words, I will, and we have said that Mr. Harry Schultz, the writer and the organizer of this book and the Kurdistan Iraq tours is here, and he will speak later. But we will start with Susan Gven, the president of the Kurdish Association in Sweden. Welcome. And she speaks better English than Harry and me.
No. Don't be modest. Okay, so distinguished participants, my name is Susanna Gilven and I am the head of the Kurdish Association here in Sweden. You are very welcome to this rare and important seminar today. Like Kurdu said, it's very special with this book because every day we Kurds meet terror and horrific pictures of Daesh, what they commit in KRG and also in Iraq and Syria. But to be able to read a book like this about the fantastic culture in Kurdistan is just completely amazing. The Kurdish people have fought for decades for peace, freedom, and democracy, and as a result, the Kurdish people have suffered a series of assaults and attacks. So the Kurdish history consists of torture, ethnical cleansing, mass deportation, abuse, and killings. We're very proud that the KRG has welcomed all the refugees in Iraq and also Kurdistan, but we're also very happy that in the midst of all of this misery, it's very gratifying that the first tour guide of Kurdistan is published by no other than Harry Schultz. And I'm very happy that you took your time to fly from New Jersey.
Well, how dare, actually.
How dare.
To come and talk about his book. So without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, please give a warm welcome with your applause to Mr. Schultz, who will tell us more about his book.
Thank you very much, Susan, for these warm words. And we have also Mr. Nawzat Hirori. Okay. He will say some words for Harry or for the book. Welcome.
Yes. Or maybe that, but okay. We need
a place for
Harry. Harry is English. Yani, tamam. Yani, he will film kir bahar.
Yes, wonderful. Yes.
How do you call it?
Yes. Okay. You are most welcome, and Mr. Harry Schultz, you are welcome to the Kurdish Library, to Sweden, and to us all. And thank you very much for this opportunity that you let me taste my English, which I don't use often, but I will do that today. in fact, when I saw this book for the first time, it made me think of two important things. First of all, I must say it's a fascinating book, and it's a very professional one, which is meant for tourism in Kurdistan. The first point which attracted me was that amid all the genocides, the miseries, and amid all the wars that Kurdistan has witnessed, there is another treasure which people do not consider or have not considered very well, and it's the Kurdistan nature and the Kurdistan beauty, which is reflected, of course, in this book, and which should be part of what Kurdistan is. The other point, in the 1980s, the Iraqi government issued a tourist guide to Iraq, and in that guide there was some few pages on the north of Iraq. They didn't call it north of Iraq, but they call it our beloved north.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was the name, our beloved north. So in those pages there were only mention of some historical places and some attractions there, for example, Gali Ali Bagh, Shaddad Gali Ali Bagh's waterfall, and there was no mention of people there, as if it's only just a place outside of the earth. And so when I saw in this book that they're full of people, full of life, and the about Kurdish cousin, about Kurdish food, about Kurdish culture and everything, that in fact attracted my attention, and you have done a wonderful work, and thank you very much for this.
Thank you very much, Mr. Nazahari, the chairman of the Kurdish Library in Stockholm. And you know, as before, when I was a child, the Kurds said always that the only friends of the Kurds are mountains. And now we know that it's not like this. And we have also in Sweden, actually, a union association of the Friends of the Kurdish Library. And Mrs. Lena Insplander is the chairman of this fantastic Friends, and she's like a mountain. She's what come.
Du kan prata där om du vill, eller här. Så
jag gjorde fel från början.
Okej.
Men funkar inte det där? Det var ju tanken från början att alla...
Hallå?
Ja, det ska bra.
Now it's working?
Yes.
So, I am the chairman of the Swedish Kurdish Friendship Association. And I'm very happy about that. I'm proud about that. And I want to tell you a little bit about our organization first, because the library is the base for our operation, what we are doing, of course, since the library is very important. But we have also another mission to spread information about Kurds and Kurdistan in Sweden. We also work now this autumn. We have started with the work to activate children in reading Kurdish fairy tales, because they have been saved in Sweden for a long time, old ones and of course also new ones, and to get the younger generation to interact in Kurdish and the Kurdish culture. We have cultural events here as well, and we are about to start a new project, I hope. We want the first people, Kurdish people, coming to Sweden. It was 50 years ago, and we are about to get these first Kurds to meet the new ones coming now. To see what happens, to talk to each other, and to experience, to evolve their, or our culture, I should say. And we need resources for this. We need more people to be engaged in that. But I think this is a good idea. And when we are doing this, we have a perfect book to refer to about Kurdistan, and this will make it much, much easier for me to tell the Swedish people about Kurdistan and the Kurds. I have been missing this book for about 10 years now, so it's about time. So, very welcome.
Yes, tell us thank about you very much. With this word, I welcome now Harry Shoot to us. Very welcome. I think. Yes, you sit next to me, because if you sit
near me, you will be in the television, so I think it's better for you.
Okay. So, you are very welcome, and you tell us why you...
Sure.
This project.
Well, thanks very much, Kakardo. It's my pleasure, my honor to be with you here, my first time ever in Sweden, so this is a bit of an interesting welcome. The rain and getting dark at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, quite an experience for somebody who's never been this far north. So, but thank you very much. I do want to give a few thank yous before I get into how this whole project came about. First and foremost, I'd like to thank the Kurdish Library and Kaknozad in particular for being the principal sponsor for this event today. Thank you very much. Very impressed when I saw the library here doing a very good thing, and I wish you a lot of success going forward with that project. Also the Kurdish Association, thank you very much for your support as well. Of course, our moderator, Kakurdo, thank you very much for taking some time out to be with us here today. And the Swedish Kurdish Association, again, thank you. I understand what you're doing, because with one of the other hats that I wear, in Kurdistan, I'm the Vice President of the America-Kurdistan Friendship Association. So we try to do, I think, the same kind of thing that you're doing, but in Kurdistan.
Actually, I have been to your events.
Ah, okay, so you know what we're about. Okay, very good.
Swedish spy.
In fact, the night before I came here, Thursday night, we had a Thanksgiving dinner celebration in Hauder. More than 300 people came, not only Kurdish Americans, people from the Kurdish community, but many Americans, foreign diplomats. So we're trying to keep up our end to make the relations between people from Kurdistan and people from America have better understanding and better relations between them. The final thank you that I have is for our two main sponsors for the book project. Because we could not have finished this project if we did not have some sponsors to help us do the funding for it, very frankly. We had a number of sponsors, probably about 30, 35 altogether, but the two who carried the heavy load were Korek Telecom and Car Group in Kurdistan. And thanks to their support, we were able to do the project. So for those who don't know, I've been in Kurdistan now for about 12 years. I got there in 2003. Came along with the U.S.-led coalition, and I was commanding a civil affairs unit in Kurdistan, in Kurdistan and North Iraq, because I had soldiers who were outside of Kurdistan as well. So, and that's how I really became introduced to Kurdistan. My academic background is in history, and so I had done some studying before I had gone to Kurdistan, got to know a little bit about where I was going, had my soldiers do the same thing. And when I got on the ground and got to see the places that I had been studying about before I arrived, and of course, you know, as time allowed, I wasn't there as a tourist when I was wearing the uniform of the United States Army. But I tried to go off on little side jaunts where I could. But I was stunned with the visual beauty of Kurdistan. I was very impressed with the people that I met in different places that I went. And I was fortunate because of the job that I had, that I was able to go literally from one end of Kurdistan to the other. Zakho to Kalar, Penjwin, to Makhmur, wherever you can imagine. There are very few places in Kurdistan I've not been to. Unlike, unfortunately, many people in Kurdistan, I think I've been to more places than I think some of them, actually. But so that gave me a good basis of foundation for knowing about Kurdistan. I guess it was in about 2007, one of my friends in Kurdistan, an American by the name of Dr. Douglas Layton, he had been there for many years before me, but we decided that the time was coming to begin to find ways to properly promote Kurdistan, especially to people outside, to people in the West, in Europe, in America, Australia, focusing, you know, on let's say the English-speaking world, but, you know, of course, many parts of Europe, English isn't their native language, but they understand, like here. And so we thought that we would try to put together some kind of a tour company to be a good vehicle to introduce Kurdistan to people as they were coming. And it was a natural fit because in the jobs that we both had as, and I was finished with the Army by that time, I was working mainly as an advisor to the KRG, but doing some other stuff as well. But we had handled dozens of delegations coming to visit Kurdistan. And so we were very familiar with taking people around and showing them what was to be seen. And so we decided to start a tour company called the Other Iraq Tours. And we officially launched in the spring of 2008 with our first tour group, which was a group from America. 2008. Which was a group from America. 18 people came on that first tour that we had. And we did that through an American tour company. And from there on, it was a pretty steady business of different tour groups coming in to visit Kurdistan. And one of the things that we did when we started our operations, we wanted to make sure that we were delivering a professional product. You know, we wanted our guests to really feel the experience of Kurdistan and experience it in a positive way, because our goal was they would go back to wherever they were from and they would talk to their friends and their family and people they worked with about what a wonderful time they had in this place called Kurdistan. So that was the objective, that we had to do it in a proper way like that. The reason we called ourselves the Other Iraq Tours was because, of course, what was going on in 2007-2008, the surge, you know, the so-called surge by the coalition forces, you know, the additional American soldiers that went in trying to really break the back of the Islamic State in Iraq at that time. And so a lot of the news that was available in the mainstream media was bad. You know, explosions, car bombs, you know, people being killed and everything. And so we were trying to force people away from that narrative by saying, yes, you know, we're in Iraq, but it's not the Iraq that you're seeing on TV. This is the other Iraq. You know, and there's a lot more to be seen and known from that other Iraq. And so that's why we chose that name as well, the Other Iraq Tours. So we operated, like I said, from 2008, and I guess it was about 2013. Yeah, 2013. Dr. Douglas and I were talking about what we can do to try to make the experience of the people that were coming that much better. Because quite frankly, one of the complaints that we were getting from some of our guests is there's no proper guidebook out there. You know, that we have no way to prepare if we want to get it in advance, and if we go back home, there's nothing we can buy here in Kurdistan to take away with us. You know, so they wanted something that was kind of a memento for them to take away with them, to share with their friends and family when they got back home. And so when we were getting requests from people to do this, we started looking around ourselves in Kurdistan, and they were right. We couldn't find anything. There were some other products out there that were prepared by, you know, different folks. But again, with us, standards has always been one of our core values, and they were not something that we wanted to give to our guests, because, you know, there were grammatical errors, there were spelling mistakes, there was just a basic lack of information in some cases. I mean, I remember one of the books that we saw, they were talking about Acre, and you know, they had a picture, the famous Nauru's picture of people marching up the hill with the fires, and the only thing that it said was Acre is a historic place 45 kilometers from the hook.
Nothing.
That's all it said. And so we thought, my God, we've got to fill in these gaps and provide more information about these different places. And so that's where our idea for the guide came from, that we thought, we're not going to find it. And so if we're not going to find it, let's do it ourselves. We'll put it together on our own. So in late 2013, early 2014, we actually started working on the project. We started the research. We brought out a photographer. We shot 4,000 new pictures for this project. And we tapped into a few other professional photographers for their stock photos as well. Did new, fresh research on 150 different locations across all of Kurdistan. And, of course, we filled in all the typical tourist information that's required, hotels, restaurants, nightlife, how you call the police, you know, what do you do if you have a health issue, all of the kinds of things that you would expect in a guidebook. We started doing all of that research in that time to gather all that information. And I want to say that we were finished by the early spring of 2014. Unfortunately, that wasn't very good timing, because I guess it was about a month after my colleague Dr. Douglas went to Istanbul to do the final layouts and the final graphic artwork with the firm that we hired in Istanbul to do this. And you might say, why did we go to Istanbul? Well, unfortunately, that was where we had to go. We couldn't find a printing house in Kurdistan that could do the job that we were looking for, so we had to go there. But he was up there doing that final work when Daesh attacked into Mosul and took over Mosul, Beji, Tikrit, and you know, further on down to the south. And so that wasn't very good for our business as operating a tour company, as you can imagine. There was suddenly every tour that we had scheduled was canceled because people just simply... They couldn't get past what they were seeing on TV. And although we knew and we were telling people the core parts of Kurdistan are still safe, you know, it's as we've seen from events in other parts of Europe here not too long ago, you've got places to be worried about in your own backyard, let alone in Kurdistan. But we couldn't get people past that notion because they couldn't picture in their mind how far away we were from the places where Daesh was, and they couldn't visualize, you know, the great job that the Peshmerga do securing the border against Daesh. So tourism is a business out the window. And so when we were working on this, we had people saying, why are you working on a tour book now? Are you guys crazy or what? You know, are you thinking that if you sell this, people are going to come to Kurdistan to do a tour? And, you know, we had experienced some of these same questions back in 2008 when we did our first inbound tour. People said the same thing, you know, why are you guys doing tours? And, you know, we proved ourselves correct back then in 2008 because we had people steadily coming. You know, were we getting rich off of it? No. But we were paying our bills. And more importantly, we were presenting the positive Kurdistan experience to everybody that we had come with us. We built the additional groups off of that concept that I talked about where people were talking to friends and family and more people were coming. So like I said, we had proven the model before in how we operated the tour company. And so we thought, you know what, we've started this project. We are about to go to press. Let's keep going forward with it. Because we said among ourselves, you know what, yes, we may not have the volumes of people coming for tours right now, but we can get onto the back of the positive press that's in the media right now about the Peshmerga I mean, you know, I of course I don't watch Swedish press, but I watch English-speaking press, and you know, the Kurds are getting pretty good coverage these days in the press. You know, they're being talked about as the ground force for the coalition, and you know, the one reliable force that's fighting against Daesh. You know, of course, there was a lot of press coverage about around Kobani and recently around Sinjar. So we thought, let's get on the back of that, but change the narrative a little bit, get away from the military side of it, and talk about, you know, again, the natural wonders, talk about the history, talk about the people, so that when all of this crisis subsides, we can hopefully directly have people decide, yes, maybe it is time to see this place we've heard so much about. And you know what, there's a pretty darn good book out there that talks about some of those things. So we decided for that reason, keep it going, get the book out there. But we also thought, let's make this a little bit of a political narrative as well. And especially in those capitals, Washington, London, for example, where support is important. And to show that we are not intimidated by Daesh, we're not frightened by what they're doing. And nor are the people in Kurdistan. Life is going on, business is continuing. Yes, there are a lot of challenges out there, there's no doubt about that. But we're continuing to drive forward because life will continue after Daesh. They will go away sooner or later, one way or the other. And so that was part of our political message that we thought we were sending out there as well. Now the book itself, as I mentioned, 4,000 photographs, 150 different locations. We're at about 400 pages for the book. We broke it down into four main sections. There's a section for each Erbil, Duhok, Sulaymaniye provinces. We did a section as well on Garmian/Kirkuk because that's how the Board of Tourism in Kurdistan breaks it out. So there's a focused section on each one of those that talks about the various things in those provinces. A section, general history, general religion, religious tolerance. There's a section on Nowruz. And one thing that we decided to do as well, we decided to give the book some kind of like a personal flavor to it as well. And we asked a number of guest experts to write articles for us in the book. For example, we have a couple of articles about Kurdish music. Adnan Karim, Chopi Fatah, both wrote articles for us in the book. Did an article on Kurdish cinema. John Oroz Bayani wrote an article for us about Kurdish cinema. Cuisine, a lady named Mrs. Chiman Zabari. In fact, she just put out a book in America about Kurdish cuisine. So we focused on her efforts. We have an article about the Peshmerga, the flora and fauna of Kurdistan. Dr. Barhan's wife, Dr. Barhan Saleh, she wrote that article for us, Women in Kurdistan. So we have a number as well of personal articles about different aspects of life in Kurdistan that we thought would take it again to the next level and personalize the book even more so. One of the other things we've done, we decided, you know, we don't want to make this a book that we print a bunch of copies of and stick them in a warehouse in Istanbul or Haller or wherever. We want to get them out. Because just like we try to do with our company, we wanted to get out the word and spread it as much as possible. So we've done a lot in that regard as well. This is actually, I guess, the fourth event that we've done of this nature. Of course, we had our launch event in Erbil. We did an event in London. The UK Parliament hosted us for that event. And we did another event in Washington, D.C., for that event, we actually gave away copies to every single member of the U.S. Congress. So we would put it in their hands and pound it into their heads about what Kurdistan is. And now here, we're in Sweden. In fact, we were talking last night about trying to find a way to get this into the hands of at least some key Swedish parliamentarians as well, for hopefully maybe the same effect.
We'll fix it.
Good. And I'll look for you guys to hopefully help with that. And I'll send more if I have to. The book's on Amazon. You know, we got it on Amazon. We have its own website. We sent copies to about 300 journalists, focusing mainly on travel journalists, but we sent it some to other journalists as well. And we sent a whole bunch to international travel agencies that are out there. Again, trying to get the book out to many different sources as we could. Again, for the various reasons that I mentioned. So Yeah, I think that's what the book is all about. A lot of effort and care and love went into producing the book. We are hoping that if the book continues with the positive reception, that we will maybe do a new edition, kind of an updated version, possibly in 2017, and we'll come out in more than English. We'll come out as well in Kurdish, Arabic, Turkish, probably a couple of European languages as well. Again, to spread the word even more. So that's what it's all about.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Now I will, in 2 minutes, translate everything you said in Kurdish.
Wow, okay.
It's
speed translation.
The women, as well as the Kurdistan in 2016, and the new Douglas Later, Mr. Dr. Douglas Later, 2017 من جهه مدیر گفت چما سفری توریستی کردستان دلال کردستان دلال شناکن وی آوی خبر دا و جا ام 2018 دلگاسیون عودی میوان سفری عودی کردستان دلگران ده 2018 ده دبیر بود است که دکم آمریکایی و اروپایی ورن وان سفری توریستی به کردستان جایی میگو اما هر کسی که چهار پنج هم خویی خوره دوست خوره اول خود کار ولاتی کل دشی باس بکه یه دیه دی اف کاری ما و فرق بود تی زحمت خود ورن ما متوجه ساکی دی که ما خلقی دی بود در آن خود کر دبیر چاقی ما اجبار کو گله بمب داده تا کنده لالی آمبار لالی بادای که کرد کوکی گله جدی من آمی دانی بود آدر ایراق یعنی ایراق دیتر ایراق کو نتر رو تی ده ایراق انجی خاک تازه دلال و خشکو بی بلا بی قضا وی جای کردستان تا بیگول ایراقی آرامی که مزد تی ده بو بیدن بو پشتی بی بیجه کو ما 2013 ده بری آرگا کو بردو که کی چکش بر گلک میوانی می اوروپی و امریکی دوتن چما رهبری که به انگلیزی نینه هم تنوی داری هم نزانه که چوب کن و ها تا خویا کرن کنه به کتیبه که رهبری گایده که توریستیک بهش بود نسته کردستان اتجار ناحتی چی کرن برای که مش بیمونوی حوالی خویا دکتور داگلاس اشتر شکایت خلقی من بریا دارم بگو به کتیبه که چی کن 2014 بحاری ده من اون پروژه خود چی کن و صد هم منطقه جدا یعنی منطقه بچوکی کردستانی که توریستیک آوله یا خوشکی و آجی تشتی یزیدال و هنه فلان و همی ها زیارت کرده مردو که از باورم جو کرده که زفتر ال کردستانی گر یامد بجه هر او ساجی دبی کو مثلا کتیبه بری سردامانه دانه چی کن دبی عکره ج هولی 45 کیلومتر دوره دیروکیه چکی دی نابیشه یعنی بس باس ناکه کنه روزاوی چاها خوش که هنجی چتی دیتر دبی او پروژه ها 2014 ده که تام تکه تا نیزان پاشه یعنی لیاوت ده که سوران بلکه نیزان پاشه زن بب ام چونه استانبول ام کتبه ها حاضر دیکن دایش که تموسو ده اینجا مشفاره گوت ام برنامه خو بردوام دیکن لیهنه که گوت نیا وش تبشت دایش عتیت چاب به یعنی تی تجارت اول تجارتی کی باشه یعنی دیو یا گو آنکه لج مخابل جبر ترسا دایش چه خیر کردستان پیش مرگز دیدک بج عرضی کنترل بکه او برنامه سفر توریستیک اتوبوس افلان کوچه کرد بون همو ابتدا بون یک حبیج نشون لی مگه به کتاب خو بر دوام بکن کتاب 400 روپیه 4000 فوتراف جبری هات نکشاند جوان 4000 فوتراف نو هم هات نکشاند نو سالی ده من 4 منطقه دا بره دو هوس لیمانی گرمیا یو سد فور دیفرنت کاتگوریز اف جیوگرافیک یو دی ور دو هوس لیمانی گرمیا کرکو ام آی میست کربیل اولیر و هولیر جاره کدی بیجم جبرکو هفه گرنگه هولیر دو هوس لیمانی گرمیا کرکو بک 4 بابت جدا دنوا پرتوکی ده جی ساندره لبر تابی مثلا ما خواستی پسپورین کل سر بابت جدا ده مزیکی ده 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 بیاتی ده ده تشتگی ده وکب مثلا خاتون چوپیر باسا مزیکی ده که فران هر کسا ما خواستی کل دوی کتبی ده بشتار ببن به حتی بگم من ام پیلان که 2017 ده چاپی کنو چیکم و او چاپ جی هم انگلیزی جوگاوه هم عربی هم کردی هم ترکی ليه ان شاء الله عم تشانس معي ديجي عم بلعب بكل حتى بقدر بالواشنطن واللندن مع كتاب داينا ساندر. You have interest the book in London and Washington DC somewhere else, did I miss? How did
no, we don't count
the Kurdistan داينا ساندر جم كيكريشي مرمونا او تشكي دي and then
we're gonna do Nashville.
Yeah. وحمو اندامين كونغره وسناتوي امريكا ايكو بور سبين وبشاف كيوالينا حمي از کتیم جمعان هایی رو دستیم آن بلاش شانگیت از دارم هم سپاسی هایی که دست خوش رو بخواهیم Then we can maybe take some questions.
Sure.
آنها کتیب می تبیه فروتان ارزانی دیکش گوی ویس ست کرونتنه یعنی گیلک ارزانه. I said that the book is about 100 crowns and I think we will buy more books than the presenting people here, existing people in this room. I can guarantee you.
Yeah.
So don't look at the number of this, because we know that we will buy more than yes. Yes. So اگر پرسیاری که وای هم به کردی آن جو انگلیسی از دوی حاضرم علی کاری آو بکن ام پرساج بکن فرمو ناتو وی
امکان بیشتر ابتدی تابع فدیستان سرپوشی
میشه تا یک سال. He says that if an American publish a book like this, does it mean that Kurdistan will be a free country? Is a kind of heritage?
Personally, I don't see why not.
Chumana, chumana.
Are you sorry?
Chumana.
Yeah, do you want to hear me? Do
It was a dream for me before,
yeah,
but now it's a reality. I'm very happy about this.
I'll tell you one little anecdote. Like I said, I was in the U.S. Army, and I served in another place that started with a K as well, a place called Kosovo. And I served there in 1999, 2000. Oh. And when I first got to Kosovo, I said, you know what? This place is going to be independent one day. and, you know, I had a similar feeling when I got to Kurdistan as well. So, I think.
بعد سال 1988 2000 از کوسوو اوکسل بازی که آمریکایی لور بود چهام پیه پتا اردم و اول آزاد و آزاد و آزاد بود کردستان روز اولی هاتم گفته آزاد بود اول دیس آزاد فرمو کاکا
پاس
میستر هاوزل از ا وری اکتیو کردیش پولیتیشن اند اکتیویست این استاکل روشه بیشتن
کوردو آمریکایی
When you have lived so much with the Kurds to set up in Kurdi, set up in American one, yeah?
No problem.
You understood what I said. 50% American and I think 51% Kurdish, 49%. Yeah, I have another question.
کرداد بینی تو وقت چه نقطه یعنی خالد گرنگ ناف کرداد هنه که بوا انترسا بویا و چه خالد که ماسی هنه یعنی اگو دیشه نسبت او وقت کردستانه که باشی و خرابیت کرده او چا هست
در سر مثلا توریزم ناجی حمو بس
حمو
حمو دو سال بگیره بس Do you see? He likes to know as an observer, as he says, a non-politician observer. If you can say the mistakes the Kurds are making today, good side and bad side of the Kurds, not just in tourism. I asked him if it was just about tourism, but he said generally, in general. So, could you give him a short answer in 1 minute and 30 seconds?
Wow. You know, I think there's a couple of things that I say to my friends that I work with in Kurdistan about the issue that you precisely said right now.
One more time, I'd like to be corrected.
Yeah, there's a couple of things that I say to the friends that I work with in Kurdistan. And those things very simply are, number one, you know, it's very important to get the narrative of Kurdistan out to the rest of the world. And to keep it out there.
You mean lobby something?
Yeah, you could say lobby to some degree.
Lobby, bashing.
Yeah. Because the reality is, in a lot of the places where it's important for that message to be heard, they have a very short attention span, maybe 15 minutes long. And one of the mistakes that I've seen some of my Kurdish friends make, they think if they say the story one time, finished. They don't need to say it anymore.
And
that's a big mistake.
You
need to say it again and again and again. The other thing is, believe me, I understand the issues of internal politics and how, you know, you could agree about one thing and I think something else. We have the same issues in America. But I think one of the things that's and again, people in Kurdistan know this issue themselves, but that is the lack of at important times and for important issues to be unified. And you know that there are some key issues out there which you all know where unity is important, and because people can't get on the same page about some simple things, they can't focus on those bigger issues.
Very good answer. Very good.
This is Zuzu's pass to Batnavi, Gross Yampe, Kayfat, to Upper Tunisia, Jara Ulwak, Askar, Kaganar, Kitchi, Bashir, Kinsan, and Madid, Nichaveda, Kishbiku, Usiki, Kurdai, Zika.
I like
how Yaki, Luji, what first as Father Generation. I have for two to serve Kuduru, Avidia Kurdiabas. و پیشروژا دو وقت عسكر بیه یا من تک امریکا یا عسكری جه و پیشروژا کوردستان باشور و جاوا
I'd like to thank you very much for coming here and for the wonderful job as you have done, and you started to know us as a Kurdistan, but now something else today. But I'd like to know if you see what future do you have in Rojava, you know, Rojava. And in Bashur, in the Iraqi and Syrian Kurdistan, do you believe that they will have their rights, something like that?
Well, of course, you know, in Bashur, in Iraqi Kurdistan, it's a very different situation because of what happened in 2003.
Bashur judaya, çünkü 2003'de nava meselede ne?
And because of what happened a year and a half ago from Daesh, I truly believe that Kurdistan is more, Iraqi Kurdistan is more on its way to being more autonomous, closer to independence than at any time.
But Rojava is coming.
I'm not there yet.
He's from Rojava, so he's just...
You know, in fact, I think that is recognized in a lot of Western capitals today as well.
The Bashur, yes.
Bashur. Mm-hmm. Because they see how Baghdad has ignored, in a lot of ways, Kurdistan.
And in
close behind closed doors, you can get some of those people to admit it, that things will not go back to the way they were before. Of course, Rojava is a bit of a difference.
Rojava judaya.
More challenging problem. This is again my opinion. It's a very complex environment, all of Syria, to include Rojava. In fact, just this morning I saw a very interesting political cartoon on both Facebook and Twitter floating around. And I'll try to describe it for you. It basically, it shows a caricature of all of the characters who are involved in Syria today. So Assad, Erdogan, Khamenei, Daesh, an Iraqi army soldier, Russia, Putin,
Hezbollah.
Right. And in the caricature, they all are holding a pistol in each hand, and they're all pointing it basically at each other. And it's who's pointing the pistol at who?
The caricature there and we film it there. Herkes de var çekti video, herkes burada ilgili. Hem kitle sağlıyor.
So Erdogan, for example, is pointing the pistol at Assad and the Kurds.
Ve Erdogan o şey, silah destek Kurda, fazla var.
The Kurds and Assad.
O Kurdji fazla Assad.
And then the Iraqi soldiers got a point under his head.
Ja Iraqi tin askeri waji bardana Kurda.
And Assad has appointed at ISIS and the rebels. So it's like this. And that's why it's complicated. But you know the thing that is very interesting that gives me hope that again the situation in Rojava will be better going forward than before are two things. One, that when this crisis started, as you know, Assad basically turned away. You know, he did not get so much involved and basically left many parts to their own devices. That's the first thing.
With the speaker there was the problem that Daesh had get.
And the second thing is that I'll say in this case the U.S.-led coalition, because it is in Syria, definitely from the Western side anyway, being led by the Americans, has been actively providing support to the Kurdish fighters, as you know, led by the IDG.
Ve Amerika koalisyonu Kalkaraya yürüdü ki rastıcı Kalkaraya YPG o an keser Kırım'ı bilir o
zaman. Very much angering Turkey that we're doing that as a matter of fact.
Zabena Türkiye, Hrakiye, Aciske Dorota Türkiye, Halikari.
But again, the reason for that is that because the U.S. government's policy, they don't look at YPG the same as PKK.
Jibelku Amerika YPG, UPKK ve Kavnabine.
And so for that reason, that's how they've justified getting that support. So, for those two reasons, I think there is a greater chance that, like Iraqi Kurdistan, that when the Daesh crisis is finished, that you will see something different in Rojava as well.
Fermul.
Yes.
You can ask because. Okay.
Do I have the right to ask?
Yes.
Yes, I have two questions. The first one is about tourism in Kurdistan. I heard that there is, or there had to be a conference on tourism in Kurdistan in these days.
Mm-hmm.
Why should there be a conference? Is it because there is too much interest in tourism in Kurdistan, or because there is a reason to just, as you mentioned, to lift the nature of Kurdistan so that to be attractive to the tourists? And maybe this is A of the question, and the B part of it, have you seen that there is many tourists that come to Kurdistan, in fact, in the last 10 years, say, or after 2003? The second question is a comment on the question, or just a suggestion on the question. Do you think that you can publish the diaries of those foreigners who come to Kurdistan and stay there and talk about their visit. I have seen myself many Russians, Americans, Europeans,
many missionaries.
Yes, and who wrote about their diaries, or just filmed some of the places that they visited. Do you think that it would also back your idea of Kurdistan tour guide when you publish them in your website, for example? Gakurdu Bege Kurdi.
Wow, man, it's
awesome. The conference of tourism is a big one of the Kurdistan, a big one. از خواهد زنم عجب عجبوی ناساندن کردستان انجیش بوی چی سببیه دویه میشی گله که انسان غریب هاتنه کردستان سال ست سال داوی در بشنه هم کردستان جیانه او رو داگوک مشید گوتا جره
روش
نویس که خواهد روش نویس اره بیرانی نخواه لفساندره او چی که کرسی پر سرپی هاتی هم خواه کردستان آنها چی او کردی لفساندر کردستان اون پیلان دکه آنها چا بگیم فرمون
اوکی So, yes, for the first one, there was a plan for a tourism conference in Erbil on the 1st and 2nd of December. Note, I said was.
Uh-huh. Yes, so it will be the conference?
There was a plan. Right. And I can tell you that spun out of a plan that the Board of Tourism had in the end of 2013. You may know that in 2014, Haller was Erbil, because it was Arab, was designated as the capital of Arab tourism for 2014. And so that conference spun out of that designation.
In 2014, Erbil اولیر پایتخت توریسم پلان جور دست فکر بود
برام yes so and so yes because it was in competition against all of the sites in the Arab world as well
دبید نابر همون جین توریستی که همه عرب آمد مسابقه کیه
and so right so and so Erbil
Will was the number one.
One as part of Iraq, you know, an Arab country. One as part of Iraq. That's how it.
As an Iraqi city, not
yes,
a Kurdish city.
Yes, as an Iraqi city.
Hawlir Aji Erbil, gore the name of the Arab ad, the Sernave Iraqi, buye kemi, the geotouristic there.
And so, much like us, you know, the Board of Tourism was impacted as well by what happened with Daesh. They had planned to have this conference a lot earlier. But they kept postponing it, kept postponing it, kept postponing it, because hoping that the situation would get better much quicker. But they ultimately decided, you know, let's do it and get it done with. So they had planned to do it on the 1st and 2nd, but it was canceled at the end of last week. And sadly, the reason it was canceled, you may not be aware, but last week, the airspace over Kurdistan was closed for a couple of days. And so the conference organizers didn't know how long that cancellation would go for. They were concerned that the guests who were going to come for it wouldn't be able to get into Kurdistan, and so they canceled the conference. And I'll tell you very plainly that the reason our airspace was closed was because Russia decided to fly some cruise missiles over Erbil. And the first time they did it, there was no warning. On the way to Syria.
Yes. I said it before you.
Okay.
I knew you would come there.
And they, fortunately, when they did that a couple more times, they let us know in advance. But nonetheless, that caused the closure of the airspace for a couple of days.
Russia,
yeah. In fact, I was worried that I was not getting here.
But today, Sweden also has decided to not fly to Kurdistan.
Oh, really? Mm. Well, and I know the UAE did as well today. So all Emirati carriers.
But you have Austrian ticket?
No, I came on Turkish Airlines, actually.
Okay, then you can go back.
I know they're a little bit more intrepid than some of the others. So that was the plan for why they intended to do it. Like us, I don't think they were so naive to think that by having that tourism conference, they would suddenly, you know, open people up to say, oh my God, we've got to get to this place, Kurdistan. But it was more they had planned to do it, they had been postponing it and thought, you know, let's get it done.
Could be also a good publicity propaganda.
Yeah, if it had been able to happen, unfortunately not. In terms of the numbers of people, I know in our case, and again, from our case, we were focused on Westerners. That was entirely our focus. Again, Americans, Europeans, Australians, Canadians. We would get a couple hundred people a year, is what we would get from our tours. But Kurdistan was taking credit for a lot more tourists than that. And before the Daesh crisis started, to be frank with you, most of the tourists who were coming were Arabs from the south of Iraq, from the Gulf countries in some cases, and especially during the different feast times of Jajans, they would come to Kurdistan. Their tourism that they were doing was very much different than what we had for our market, because our tourism, we were focused on this stuff, you know, what's in here. We were focused on introducing the people, the history, the sites. The Arab tourism that was coming in was mainly focused on spending time in the hotels, going to the shopping malls, and in the hot weather they might go up to Galilee Beg or Jundian or something like that to put their feet in the water. That was it. So that's number two. Go ahead with that.
Yeah. Van seferi turistik, van seferi turistik boy. Australia, Asia, Europe, America, and the next Christian Rambish, after Bonawan, but Blankiru, but Salas is such a Kazata. They are Haki Kuristani, who's after Isan, whatever it is, but since such a Satan, they are Arab Dad. Our Arab Dad, Ahlaki wanted to receive the treble. Oh, Lotel Rutin, Huarna Zahar, Dijini wanted the Canada Sham Shadakru, the Shona Malawa. Jam Mr. Yemenabulian, in the next question, Helen G. بحرین ناجیه چی خوش چی آبگر جان جار به هر چی آب پیدا کرد و بی ام سری فکر کنم.
And for the final bit of your question, that's a very interesting idea. I mean, we have taken some snippets of comments from people and, you know, put them on our website and everything. But expanding on that is an interesting idea. We have had people come and write full blogs about their visits with us. You know, we've had people write news articles about their visits with us. We've actually had a few tourists since Daesh started, and a couple of them came as journalists. I mean, they came and did the tourism stuff, but they also came and did journalism stuff as well, interviewed people, and then published articles about their visits. In fact, we just had a tour last week with a German guy.
Yeah.
We are getting onesies and twosies. But not the dozens that we used to get before. So.
به آنات هم میشته که داعش آتیه مشتری ما کیم بوده گوییم گله گروش نمی‌وانتی نه وی بلوگ هم نیستی نه وی آبکی اینجا هم مواد گرینن و اوجی دیشن لغلات پر روش نامه مسند بدن نیستی نه وی آوجی رخ نامه کی باشد بود. Yes, I think the other question was the books of the diaries of the Western people coming in Kurdistan. He asked.
About. He already answered.
We are ready with this. No, I'm asking you if you are happy with the
question. Yes, of course. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
I had a question.
Yes, you first and then she, I think. Yeah.
So, thank you very much for this amazing illustration. I can't wait to read the book. I think it's just amazing. I have a question. I was in Hewlett a few weeks ago, and I love the city, of course, because I'm Kurdish, and I love the culture and everything. But I could not get away from the fact that there are tons and tons of buildings, hotels, and everything just they're standing still. I mean, in some areas it looks like a ghost town, And you've written this amazing tour guide about Kurdistan, but what is your thought? Do you think that these buildings will start building again and people are going to start being active despite the fact that Daesh is in the area, or do you think that this is going to stand still until everything is settled down?
You can answer that.
Okay. Good question. You know, I'll be frank, okay? I guess that's the best way, right?
Yeah.
Can you repeat the question? We couldn't hear it.
The question is, she was just in Haller a few weeks ago, and when she was there, she saw a lot of construction that was stopped. Mm. You know, different projects that were in various stages of completion, and in some areas it looked like, you know, a ghost town because nothing was happening. And so the question was, you know, what do I think about, will that be completed? What's required to get that going? That kind of synopsis,
exactly.
Right?
Yes.
Okay. So, you know, there's a couple of reasons why I think that is the way it is. First, again, with Daesh coming, I think a lot of the investors who were working on a lot of those projects, they became very conservative.
Yeah.
Because I think some of them were concerned, how long will this go on? What will things look like when it's finished? Maybe I should just keep my money close to the vest right now, instead of pouring more money into something I don't know what's going to happen with it. I mean, because I'll give you an example. You know, we've had many hotels built in Kurdistan in the last 8-9 years. You know, from the big guys, Divan, Rutana, Marriott's under construction, Kempinski's under construction, Erbil. We had the real Sheraton open in Duhok, Rixos, Grand Millennium and Suleimani. So a lot of hotel construction down to, you know, the 2 and 3 star kind of operations. Since Daesh has come, more than 70 hotels have closed. 70 have closed in Kurdistan because they're not filling rooms. And so, you know, for a lot of those projects that were maybe services or tourism related, you know, whether it was other hotels or restaurants or shopping, they decided, let's hold off. The other problem that we have is there is a physical cash problem in Kurdistan.
Yeah, I wanted you to say it.
There is a physical cash problem in Kurdistan. Mm. And literally, I mean, you can go to the bank and you can have thousands or millions or whatever in your account, but there is not money in the bank to match what you have in your account. And so that is the other problem. Again, if you're one of those investors who's building one of those projects and you have, you know, the cash on your account in the bank, you can't pull it out to do the work.
Yeah.
So it's a twofold problem. And, you know, the cash problem is directly connected to Baghdad. Yeah, it's until those two things are resolved, a lot of those projects are going to stay stalled, is the unfortunate reality.
Спасибо.
Thank you.
خاتون پرستیز خاتون سوزان پرستی گفت لحولیر گله کی انشاءات هات نسخنده نو هنگ منطقه جی و کی بازار خیالاتی نه یعنی کسی دینه انسان کیه من چما مسابیه و جی باست که دبیکو آنها جبر کو دکو تایش کرد کردستانه هنگ کی تجار ترسیا گوتنم میزانس ویدوس با اولیر چی بوده و جی تماتیه کی رو خپاش تکشاندن جبر و حتی وگه جه هفته هتل نکردستانی هاتیه گرفتن جه سال چویه هتل مزن یعنی و جبر کو هتل ترجیح کنن هتل میوانا پر کیم بیه نکار خواهی بکن سبب اینکه دیجی او پری پیش کردستانی کیم بیه مثلا بانکی بلا میلیاره که تجیه بگو آتو هری میلیاره که نداده دی بیجی هزار داده دی بیجی تنیه یعنی جبر کو پری حقیقت بانکی او پری اختاره کته سر حسابت رقم هیه بس در پراتیکی دوی پری تو نکاری جبر بستی اوجی سوژداری میشه بغدادیه. اش برکو بغداد پر نشین اش بناهیم سر. اوجی پرسیدیم. سپس نستا یا.
I would like to go to this tourism business.
Yeah, finally someone speaks about that.
Yes, and I agree with you. The Western view of this, because I would like to bring my friends there to show them this. wonderful country.
Of course.
It's not the right time right now, I'm aware of that. And there are two categories. There are the ones who are like me or even older. They have a lot of money. They have seen almost all the world, but not Kurdistan.
Yeah.
They would like to have convenient hotels. They would like to everything to be very convenient. That's one group.
Mm-hmm.
The other group is the younger generation. Mm-hmm. They want to climb the mountains. You said, I'm the mountain.
Climb the mountains.
Yes, and adventures.
Mm-hmm.
I think both these categories, and there is of course others as well, but they can read the book.
Mm-hmm. For sure.
For sure.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yes, and they can get an image of what they can expect. I don't want to tell them about these bad things, about all the garbage, about all these ghost buildings and things like that, because they can discover it by themselves. But they should have this wonderful feeling, I think, because you get it when you come there. Everyone does that. We have been talking in our organization, the Swedish Kurdish Friendship Association, about arranging travels. Also for Sweden. And when I have my speeches and things like that, I always got the question, can I go there? Can you arrange a travel for me, for the Swedish persons, for teachers, for a lot of persons who want to know more? So there is, of course, a big interest. And I think you should start in a way, in a bit different way, and then we can start earlier. If there is a company in Sweden called Läs och Res, read and travel. So you read first and then you go there.
Yeah, we have a couple of ladies in Sweden.
I think to many people, at least the one more educated, they want to do it this way, to read first and then go there. What do you think about these kind of ideas?
Yes, absolutely. Welcome. Come on down. Let me back up though to cover all your comments. You know, your comment about who's coming to Kurdistan, at least before, is exactly correct. To be very frank with you, most of our early tourists were the kind of people you were talking about. Older folks, you know, retirees, again, people who have, you know, in some cases they had been to 150, 175 different countries.
Oh my God.
And, you know, they heard about this place, Kurdistan, and they wanted to check that off of their bucket list as well. So we were having a lot. I mean, we had one person, 87 years old, came and went to every place we go to, climbed all the steps at Al-Kosh in the monastery, Hormiz Monastery, walked all the way up to Shandar Cave.
Shandar Cave.
Shandar in Marzahn region. So did everything, which was a shock for us at 87 years old. Those kind of folks, you know, we can easily accommodate because our core business as a tourism company is as a custom luxury tour company. So that very naturally fit into what we do because we would put people in the 5-star hotels. Only took them to the best restaurants, and we would literally take care of them from portal to portal. We would meet them at the airport, drop them off at the airport, and handle everything in between. The other kind of tourist, the younger set as you're talking about, they're interested in a couple of things. Some of them are the backpacker crowd, as you're talking about. Frankly, most of them are not interested in coming with us, and we—that's not to say that we're not prepared to put people in a 3-star hotel or whatever. We are. We have done that, but a lot of them are looking for kind of like the youth hostel kind of thing. And of course, there is no youth hostel in Kurdistan. There's not that kind of thing. But we have had younger folks who have wanted to have, call it the Speed Kurdistan experience. We even had one guy, he flew in one night, spent a day doing literally as fast as our guy could drive to as many places as he could go and left the next night.
Wow.
He wanted to get that stamp in his passport to say he had been in Iraq and to see everything he could in a day. So, you know, we have had people do that as well. You know, in terms of cooperating for folks who are here in Sweden, absolutely. The back of the book is our website. If you've got this, for example, this company, put them in touch with us. If they are willing to send people here, to Kurdistan. If they're willing to send people to Kurdistan, we'll happily show them around. And one thing that we have always done, I hope I'm not talking too
much. No, no.
You got all this? You're good?
Yes.
Two-minute translation. Okay. The other thing that we have often told tour companies that are interested in working with us, because I'll be honest with you, for me, tourism is a hobby, really. It's not my main job. Shalom back here knows my main job. I advise the Minister of Interior. That's my main day job. So that means I'm pretty plugged into what's going on in security in Kurdistan. So we tell folks, listen, we are not going to send you to some place where there's a security problem. We very well know where it is safe to go and where it is not safe to go. And thankfully, in the core part of Kurdistan, called the official part of Kurdistan from the Constitution of 2005, right now there's only one place we don't go to, St. Matthew's Monastery on Makhlub Mountain. Everything else is in our normal route. So, you know, we tell folks, we will take care of you. You know, again, thankfully, knock wood, that's been the case. So I hope maybe this company, for example, might be interested in being a pioneer in restarting folks coming back. So I'm happy for that.
Yes.
دبیش که پرسیاری که هر دو سر مشتری جو یعنی چی مشتری تنها کردستانی تریست آمریکین گو که لکی جوانا به امر دنیای زعدر یعنی 105 107 دوره زیارت کنه گفته من که کردستانش ببین همه پاسپورت ما نبلا دیار به کو هم چونه و هات نمیدره دبی 87 سالی ها یک 87 سالی جهاد بود نزدیک دبی همون برنامه خود زو ما به ما را داد چو سرچ یا اوت کی نه پروبلمی تو نه اوج دعوا نیه او به جا خورت کی هاتو گو 24 ساعت ده همو کردستان گری ای کوی کو اومد گو اشاره تو کی گو تا ما شو خاطری و من وی در جدید یعنی گله کی خو جینه کی باور یعنی چی سوچ اوی دیتر ده به جا کو کردستان جی مشتری مشتری جوان ده به جن اوی کو چمپیون پشتوان ده اوزان ام کورماجی به جن چهار نیف سرسری آتیم او جا واندران هم بکردی چی هم؟
نینت
نینت کردی اما یعنی واندران هم خواب یعنی چیه که ارتان دو مثلا به 6 7 یورو الوجی تنه کردستان زانه او که هتل سیستر که مهنه جوانا بجید کم او نورمال مشتریه متی پری ویزاف امره و خوازن هتل 5 تر رازن او مشتری کو تینم جه بالا فرخانه دگرن وان برنامه وان حمید دن شکرن اما پاشی وان داتین وردیسا حتا ری ترمینالی وان یعنی او گزارو که اما خوید که موافق کرن کو تشک وان نمه یلا جوان جی جبر مثلا پاراستان کردستان اید ترسن هم اما غرانتی دن وان کو تشکی نیسری وان او یاسای کو 2015 لبغدای و کردستان او سینوری کو هی ام دول ده حرکت کن یعنی او ناچن جی کو کو غرانتی آوینی نه حقوقی جی هم بشن ویدره و ناخو ناخو ما بلایا جو خیلی نویش خواه ویدیمون حمی زانم پس نحو جدا هم کم تمام برس تکی دی اداوی سیست لاست کوسشن
Do you have any plans to extend it throughout the parts of Kurdistan?
یا دوباره تو توازی که تیم مزدتر بکی هر شب پرشه کلیزان تبیر این آمه با به سیرو باش گود
I've been asked that question before, so I'm a little bit prepared for this one. Actually, we've discussed it. My colleague Dr. Douglas and I, we've discussed doing a, let's call it Greater Kurdistan.
Kurdistan, you must have planned the Kimberley.
Not right now, no. I don't know if we want to make that big of a political statement right now. We talked about it. We're thinking about it. We want to focus on the other version that I told you, the updated and other languages version. And then once that's done, you know, 2018 or so, we'll see what's going on.
من ببینم که چه وادی به نویگا کردستان آمازون همی امنی کارن اون که اجبار از سیاسی خبر دم نویگا یا کسرا معفو کن. So you mean you in just write about the small brothers, not the big brother of Kurdistan? The small brothers. Rojavan Bashir. You go on internet to say, "Hardy Brian, which you've been seen in Kurdistan?"
Yeah. All four parts. all four parts.
Thank you very much for the questions.